Welcome to another video of Careers Express, brought to you by the Cypriot Mail, where job seekers and professionals can stay up to date with what matters most in our world of work. Today, we will talk about Cypriot women in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, and what it takes to get women into STEM studies. Joining me for our discussion is the president of Frederick University Council, Natassa Frederickou. Natassa, welcome. It's an honor to have you with us.
Thank you, Elisabeth, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak about such an important topic.
Firstly, let's begin with some statistics. According to Eurostat, the proportion of female scientists and engineers varied widely in 2019, ranging from 55% in Lithuania to 35% in Cyprus. So let's start there. Why were there fewer women majoring in STEM subjects, and how has the situation changed now?
In order to answer your question, Elisabeth, I think we need to see the problem over time. I will start by saying that in the 120 years of Nobel Prizes in medicine, physics, and chemistry, prizes were awarded 599 times to men and 23 times to women. Only 22 women have won the Nobel Prize in these fields, since Marie Curie won it twice, once in physics and once in chemistry. Today, only 30% of researchers around the globe are women. Such huge disparities, such deep inequality, do not happen by chance. Too many girls are held back by discrimination, biases, social norms, and expectations that influence both the quality of education they receive and the subjects they choose to study.
Wow, the numbers are shocking. In your opinion, what are the main challenges Cypriot women face in STEM industries?
In general, the percentage of both women and men working in STEM professions in Cyprus are among the lowest in the EU. In the information and communication technology sector, for example, the gap is significant, 1.2% for women versus 4.8% of men, according to the Women in Digital Scoreboard 2021. Cyprus ranks at number 24 in Europe. According to the European Gender Equality Index 2019, fewer women, 4%, compared to men, 27%, work in occupations in the fields of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. So even if women choose to study a science or an engineering subject, most women are not motivated to pursue a professional career in these fields. They often fear that in a male-dominated workplace, they will be not taken seriously or that they will have to deal with a sexist work environment. Often, because of the inequalities that exist, they feel that they will not have the same opportunities for advancement as their male colleagues or that they will be paid less than. These perceptions about the working environment are quite strong, and we see them here at the university as well with our students. We see how these perceptions affect a family's decision. Around the world, substantially more women are enrolled in science-based fields such as pharmacy, biology, and medicine than in mathematics and physics. Here at the university, we have many more women in our architecture and pharmacy programs, for example, in contrast to more hardcore engineering programs such as mechanical engineering, electrical, automotive engineering, or civil engineering. I can still remember an example of one of our students that she told me that when she decided to study civil engineering, her father didn't speak to her for 6 months. The reason was because he wanted her to change her mind out of fear. He was afraid that his daughter was going to end up in a hostile environment for women. So it is very important that workplaces create an inclusive corporate culture where female engineers and scientists thrive and progress.
So how can secondary school trigger girls' interest in STEM programs?
I believe that if we depend on secondary education, it is too late. We need to understand that and target the particular obstacles that keep female students away from STEM. We need to stimulate interest from the earliest years. When a girl chooses school lessons, she's often influenced by prejudice and stereotypes, which tend to consider science lessons and professions to be male in nature. For example, practical thinking is considered a male characteristic. According to some studies, children express the stereotype that mathematics is for boys and not for girls as early as second grade, that is around 8 years of age. In these studies, these children applied the stereotype to themselves. Boys identified themselves with math, whereas girls did not. So all these affect the choices of girls and their studies. Girls are reluctant to choose subjects related to science and technology, even when they have excellent performance in the specific courses. I don't think we need to trigger their interest in STEM programs. Girls are naturally explorers. They are naturally curious, creative, innovative, problem solvers. All these are characteristics of someone who is in STEM. The problem is that we make girls believe that they have limits, that these fields are not for them. An additional factor, I think, is the lack of female role models. You cannot aspire to be someone who you cannot see. If girls only see men mathematicians, they only see men engineers, only men computer scientists, they cannot imagine themselves in these roles. So to go back to your question, we need to combat stereotypes in schools and at home. We need to train teachers about unconscious gender bias, how they speak to children, what they encourage them to do. We need to develop curricula that are gender sensitive, and we need to make women in STEM visible. Girls need to see role models.
Are there role models for Cypriot women seeking a career in STEM?
Of course, there are examples of successful Cypriot women with career in STEM. The problem is that they are not a lot in comparison to men, and they are not visible. Role models are extremely important, and girls need to see women in these fields. This is something that we identified, and we're in contact with several women in different fields that are willing to talk to girls and share their experiences with them.
You mentioned women in high positions are not visible. Are they being sidelined, or is it their choice?
Okay, Cyprus ranks quite low. We are 24th in the EU in regards to women in power. In all fields, women do not hold powerful positions. The share of women among ministers is at 15%. The share of women members of parliament is at 18%. The representation of women in local council is at 15%. The share of women among the board members of the largest publicly listed companies is at 11% and at 13% on the board of the central bank. Women comprise 25% of board members of research funding organizations, 33% of board members of publicly owned broadcasting organizations, and only 5% of members of the highest decision-making bodies of national Olympic sport organizations. So in some fields, in some industries, women may be even more than men at lower level, but we see that men are the ones who progress in powerful positions. I don't want to give details, but in one of the most reputable firms I know personally here in Cyprus, more than 50% of the senior managers are women, but about only 10% make it into partners. There are a few reasons for this phenomenon. The main reason is that there is no support for women. Women are expected to take care of the family, the kids, the house. Many times, as a result, some women do not want to advance their careers. In other cases, even if they want to progress, it is impossible for them to do so. And in some cases, the ones who decide to not advance women out of prejudice, that they will not be able to live up to the expectations of the position because of all the other things they are expected to do.
In terms of Gen Z girls, we are talking about the young digital natives. Does this make them more suited for STEM studies?
Yes, nowadays children are indeed digitally more literate, but this is not the problem. The problem, as I said before, has to do with stereotypes, with social norms, with expectations that we have for boys and girls. We associate math, sports, science, power with boys, and at the same time, we associate sensitivity, gentleness, politeness, literature, music, arts with girls. This is very limiting for everyone. We need to let children become who they want to become without placing limits.
Assuming women choose to study STEM at university, what would you say are the most important resources for their success?
Something which I think is very important is for female students to believe in themselves. In a classroom full of men, the experience may be daunting, intimidating, and overwhelming. women who choose to study STEM are a minority at the moment. And while they are usually very good, they lack self-confidence. Many times we see that it is quite difficult for them to raise their voices in a room full of men. This is something that it is also our responsibility to empower them and to give them voice.
Looking now at the graduate level, are there any particular STEM research areas that are attracting women at the master's and PhD level?
At the graduate level, it is even more difficult for a woman to study in STEM if she doesn't have the background at an undergraduate level. You can find women in science, education, in pharmacy, in architecture, as I said before, but it is not so common to find women in technology or in engineering. In addition to this, all over the world, there is the phenomenon of the leaking pipeline of lost talent. We see that girls who choose to study science at the bachelor's level and even at the master's level do not continue their studies at a PhD level. There is a dramatic drop of numbers in PhD level.
How would you describe the career prospects of Cypriot women graduates in STEM?
What I will say is not only for Cyprus, it is something that is happening globally. Right now, with the technological changes happening in our world, we are going through the fourth industrial revolution. The occupations in the fields of technology, science, and engineering present excellent employment prospects with attractive salary packages. By 2050, half of the jobs in the world today will disappear, affecting women to a greater extent. If women cannot make the transition to technology and science, they will lose access to the labor market. In contrast, many occupations that have traditionally been made by women tend to be less well paid. So women around the world are at a disadvantage level more than men. By 2030, it is estimated that between 40 million and 160 million women will need to change careers and move to more specialized roles that require more sophisticated digital and cognitive skills. If women are not able to make this transition, they will lose access to even more and better paid jobs opportunities that can offer them significant prospects and greater financial independence.
Can you give us an example, a country getting it right in encouraging girls to choose a future in STEM, and what can we learn from them?
Okay, this is not an easy question, and the answer may come as a surprise to a lot of your viewers. The truth is that countries that have high numbers of women in STEM are not the countries someone would expect. As you said in the beginning, Elisabeth, in the EU, Lithuania has the highest number of women in STEM professions. We can also see good numbers in Bulgaria, Latvia, Portugal, and Denmark. Across Europe as a whole, however, men dominate high and medium high technology manufacturing. 83% of scientists and engineers are male in those sectors, compared with 55% in scientific services. In Asia, women make up the majority of researchers in Azerbaijan, Thailand, Kazakhstan, Georgia, Armenia, and Kuwait. In the Americas, Bolivia, Venezuela, Trinidad and Tobago, Guatemala, Argentina, and Panama all have more than 50% female researchers, as do New Zealand and Tunisia. So what is special about these countries? For some, especially in Eastern Europe and Central Asia, gender equality in science is a legacy of their membership of the Soviet Union, where female participation in science was actively encouraged, often in government-funded facilities. Others, like the Nordic countries, lead the world in gender equality thanks to ambitious welfare and social policies that help women in their workplace. As we said earlier, women are better represented in the health sector as opposed to engineering and information technology. So countries with more prominent medical research tend to have a better balance of women. So the answer is not straightforward here. It is too risky to compare countries, since there are many factors that influence the percentage of women in STEM. From the above examples, however, we see that some factors that contribute are, as we said before, stereotypes in countries where, for one reason or another, science and engineering are not considered male fields, such in the case of ex-Soviet Union countries, and there are many women scientists and engineers, young girls also choose to follow this path. State policies that support women is something which also appears to be very important, like the case of the Nordic countries. So in a nutshell, I believe that the way forward is to make women in these fields more visible so young girls can see what they can become, implement policies that support women in the workplace, and create inclusive corporate cultures where female engineers and scientists can thrive and progress.
Are there any movements globally and locally that are promoting women in STEM?
Of course. In recent years, the global community has made great efforts to encourage girls and women to get involved in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. On February 11, the United Nations celebrates the International Women and Girls Day in Science. Mr. Guterres, the Secretary General of the UN, said that boosting the number of women and girls entering careers involving STEM is vital to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals. This is something that we see that a lot of leaders started to understand nowadays. The effort is intensified since leaders now understand that girls and women have an important role to play in finding solutions that will improve our lives because they bring with them different experiences, perceptions, and ideas. Equal representation of men and women in the fields of technology and engineering will contribute to a fairer, more resilient, and more sustainable world, as solutions to many of these challenges we face are currently designed primarily by men, resulting in many products and technologies not meeting the needs of women and girls. So we need diversity in order to achieve real innovation, growth, ingenuity, and creativity.
If the number of women in STEM were to rise, would that automatically close the wage gap between the genders, or are there other factors to consider?
That would be a step towards the right direction, I think, but it will not solve the problem completely. In some fields where there is no underrepresentation of women, we see men advancing and taking the managerial positions while women stay behind. An example here in Cyprus is in the field of education. While the majority of primary school teachers are women, the percentage of women head teachers is not proportional to the percentage of women teachers. This is a systemic problem, so we need systemic solutions. We need government-led initiatives that will support women in the workforce, such as gender pay gap reporting, targets for women on executive boards, flexible work structures, shared parental leave, and good childcare facilities. Now, the impact of COVID seriously risks undoing the progress made over recent decades as women bear the burden of increased workloads linked to childcare, homeschooling, domestic responsibilities, and caring for elderly relatives who may be isolated during lockdowns. Evidence is coming at the moment to light of fewer submissions to academic journals and grant applications by women, as well as evidence of women being made redundant more readily than their male counterparts among the most recent company hires. One of the things that were highlighted during the pandemic, however, is the necessity of technology. Everybody understood the impact and the importance of technology, and this is something that we will see if will have an impact and an effect on the choices of future generations in regards to their chosen fields of study.
Before we go, what is your final advice to women?
My advice is for girls not to let anyone tell them what they can and what they can't do. They should be able to dream and believe that they can achieve their dreams. But I find it unfair to put all the weight and all the responsibility on women. As I said many times so far, we on a governmental level and as a society need to help them in order to be able to do that. We need to let them dream and believe that anything is possible, but also provide the means that they will be able to do so.
Finally, where can people learn more about Frederick University?
As a university, we are committed in promoting gender equality. That is why we are implementing a long-term awareness campaign targeting girls from a young age, informing them about the prospects of these sectors in order to reduce the gender gap that exists at the moment in education as well as the industry. And since last year, we are giving a 50% scholarship to all women who choose to start a program at our School of Engineering. We know that the scholarship alone will not do much since this problem has deeper roots, but it is not so easy to change stereotypes, perceptions, and prejudice. This is why we believe we need to start from an early age. We join forces with successful women in these fields who can be an inspiration for girls of all ages. And we also plan a series of experiential workshops and interactive events to bring school children in touch with these areas. The campaign is under the auspices of the Commissioner for Gender Equality, and people can find more about the campaign through our website.
Natassa, thanks so much for sharing these valuable insights.
Thank you, Elisabeth, and thank you for this opportunity to speak about this important issue.
Thanks also to you, our Careers Express viewers, for joining us. If you found this video useful, please like, share, and subscribe to this channel and follow us on our social media as well. See you in a new video very soon.